Ronnie from Ronnie's Garage in Southern California, and we're having our monthly tech meet here today, and we're going to be looking at a 1967 Silver Shadow block and talking about the cylinders, the crankshaft, and all that kind of stuff.
Bought the rods. This has got an oil feeder on it, doesn't it? So the wrist pin only gets oiled by oil splashing around in there. There's holes on here. Wrist pin doesn't get much. The six-cylinder engines actually had a little hole drilled in them with a little port. They would squirt the cylinder on the drive side to keep it lubricated, because that's where all the pressure was. The lifters, these two front studs right here are hollow, okay? And they go into this oil galley passage. This is the front of the camshaft. There's a plate on here that holds the camshaft in to keep it from coming out. The gear, show you this. This does not have a chain. This has gears. Okay, this is your camshaft gear that turns on that one. That's high quality. It's expensive. That's why most other manufacturers use chains. There's cheaper. Plus, when you go to overhead cam, you got to have chains. Right? So this right here is a plate that holds the camshaft in. Okay, and this is all fed with oil right here. And this little nozzle here squirts on those gears, timing gears, keep those oiled. Plus, there are passages right here, right there and there, that go back and feed all these lifter bosses. And then there's also little spots in that, through that passage, that feed the cam bearings, or the cam bearing surface. This has got a little groove in it. That's your oiling system. The lifters, I don't have any here right now, but they have a hollow center where the push rod goes in, and they will allow oil to go up to that part of the rocker that touches the push rod. These are hollow right here, so they get oil pressure here, and they have little cross drill holes to feed the rocker arms, which are the things that open the valves. That's your oiling system. The distributor goes in the back. There's another gear on the back of the camshaft that turns the distributor. Actually, all of these are hollow to a point because they have bolts that go in the center on the top row. That's what holds the rockers on. Question?
Are you going to tell me? The ones that are the arms, are those just like a pattern bearing, or those needle bearings?
No, not needle bearings. They are, the earlier ones, the Cloud 2s, had Babbitt or brass, bronze, copper, whatever, and they would wear really badly. So you could replace them and hone them and all that. The Shadows, not sure if the Cloud 3 had them. From then on, they were just steel, iron. Yeah.
They have, in aircraft engines, I know they have some additives that supposedly keep things coated. Have you heard anything about those or use any of their oil additives?
There's one that I use. That you go to the parts store and they have that little plastic display with all the gears and the little handle, and you turn it and the oil goes up and it stays. I forget what that stuff is, but
Lucas,
yeah. And that's a good idea.
The oil stabilizer.
Yeah, that's what it's called, yeah. The oil stabilizer. STP would do the same thing. That old school STP. That's pretty amazing stuff.
Do you recommend?
What?
Pro-lube.
Yeah. There's a lot, and there was, AMSOIL had some stuff too, I think.
You recommend it?
If you got a problem, doesn't hurt. I mean, I take vitamins every day. Do I have to? I don't know. I take special supplements to help me stabilize my cellular basis, mitosis, or whatever they call it. I take stuff that's supposed to help my brain not forget so much. So I don't know. I don't know if it works.
Have you ever
But it's, it makes me feel better, it makes me feel more secure. What?
You ever forget to take your pills?
Yeah, well, that's why they have those little boxes with all the dates on them. Yeah, one thing I use STP for, this is really kind of funky. STP is a mineral-based oil, or it mixes with them. And I had a Silver Cloud 3 come in that the power steering, when it got warm, it had no pressure. And it was just a worn-out old pump. I couldn't find parts at the time. This was years ago. So what I did is I drained the fluid out of the system. I put two bottles of STP in it and then topped it off. It's worked perfect ever since. So I use it on all the steering box work that I do because it raises the viscosity, so it's a little bit thicker and helps take up any extra clearance in a worn pump, or gives a little more boost. It's kind of funky. And they even make there's another steering box lube for old cars. It's called Penrite steering box lube. It's 1200 weight. You got to use a heat gun to heat the bottle to get it into the box, but it doesn't leak. You put 90 weight in an old steering box, and if the seals are old and the bushings are bad, it's going to leak right on the ground. The only time when I add it to old cars, pre-war cars, that the thing leaks is when the 90 weight floats up and comes out. Once it's all 1200 weight, it doesn't go anywhere. It's pretty amazing stuff. Any questions on the engines? This is, just so everybody knows, even you out there in YouTubeville, first of all, do not call me. I will not respond to you. Email me, and you will get the typical response. But what I do here, what we do here for the club and friends of mine, is we just kind of do an overview and explain kind of how things work. Sometimes I'll get into what to watch out for, be careful. The most profitable YouTube video I ever did was the one on the Silver Cloud steering box, because I had lots of people go ahead and try it, even though I told them not to. And I ended up getting their steering box in my shop and charging them to fix what they had f***ed up. So, so anyways, this is what this is about, to help educate people, not show you how to fix everything, because sometimes it's dangerous. And there is, I wish somebody would send me one of those. There's an organization that certifies automotive mechanics. It's called ASE, and they have patches, and they have the Master Tech one and all that kind of stuff. I saw somebody sent me a picture of one that was YouTube certified, and it looked just like the ASE patch. And, you know, YouTube is dangerous. It's great, but it's dangerous. Right, and that's a big danger. There's a couple of dangers in welding something, especially, you know, aluminum is porous,
right.
And even though the pores are really small, oil gets in there. And when you're welding and oil starts coming out, it's not going to stick. It's not going to work. And it's really hard to clean out. This other part that's hard is this is a big piece of aluminum. And the heat required to weld on a big heat sink like this, so the heat dissipates real quick. You really got to control. You either put it in an oven, right, and do it that way, and then what happens is things kind of move around. The whole block will twist and crack, or not necessarily crack. So I've seen a lot of attempts at that, to be honest with you.
That's why they would add weld to all of the bearing journals and then re-bore the bearing journals.
Well, yeah, the bearing journals, yeah, that's important, because it's going
to
be square, true. I just haven't seen it done yet. You got, also remember, you got all these steel things in here that you can't really pull out effectively, so they're going to suck up a lot of heat. This one goes way down in here, screws in way down there, both of these. And these on the end are right up at the top.
Then if you do something like that and it doesn't work, you're really screwed.
Right. Okay, well, it's $4,000 to weld your block. Oh, sorry, it didn't work. Oh, and it's $20,000 to take it apart and put it back together again, plus parts.
When did the blocks change? I know they went from the 6.2 to the 6.7.
I think 69 was when they still had a short crank or a short throw, and then after that, 70 maybe, I don't know. When they started putting emissions on it, I think. You'd have to look it up. There's a VIN break, I'm sure, but I don't know exactly. Might be.
87.
Yeah, it does have a VIN break. 87.42. So that's probably 69.70 range. I'm pretty sure.
87.42.
Yeah. This one is an early car. It's 31.74. It's a very early car. It's a left-hand drive. Pretty rare.
But they didn't put the VIN on all the blocks either, did they?
Well, this has a serial number for the block, but I don't know. I just saw that when I was working on it yesterday, pulling this part, and I know that that's not the serial number, that's the block number, but this matches the VIN number, the last four on the VIN number. So I think they might have on a lot of them.
Well, they had, what I read, they have SY and SYL. L is a long stroke.
Okay, so that's this number up here.
That's
this is an SY.
Well, SY is a shorter stroke.
But there's an extra boss here to stamp, and this looks like it was hand stamped. You know, this looks like it might have been machine stamped.
So, from all of the longer strokes, 6-7 blocks that are pretty much interchangeable?
The big difference is going to be...
Is that rear seal?
No, the rear seal was much later. The boss is for the accumulators. Because mid-year 75, they took and moved the number one on this side, so there's bosses on the block. That's a big thing. And then I think in 77, they changed it again because the oil filter is a screw-on, so they're not interchangeable.
So any of the double accumulator boss blocks,
well,
if they're long stroke, they ought to all be interchangeable, right?
I would think so, yes. In fact, the blocks should be interchangeable no matter what. The only thing they changed was the stroke. So the crankshafts are different. The block will be the same. And what they do is, when they call it a long stroke, what they do is they move this pin out a little bit more, quarter inch or whatever it was, so that the piston comes down further. Because displacement is bore times stroke times how many cylinders, right? In cubic inches or centimeters. Pretty amazing blocks, to be honest with you. I've taken a lot of engines apart, around 100,000. You don't even see. You just put the bearings back in. There's no wear. As long as they're taken care of and not overheated. That's the one big killer. It's a big issue. They don't usually have oiling problems. I hardly ever I've seen oiling problems, you know, where the oil pressure, unless I know that one aftermarket maker made these gears and they did something wrong and they were shearing the teeth off with brand new gears. So I've always been kind of hesitant to go down that path. But I think they've got it refined now.
Doesn't like Prestige or Flying Spurs have aftermarket pistons available?
Not for these.
No.
They do for the six cylinders.
I've never looked.
I think they might. I think Flying Spurs might show some now, but I'm always so nervous because I don't like that noise. It's bad enough to have to put up with the brake pump and lifter noise on these cars, but when you start throwing piston noises in, you know, it doesn't. It sounds like a popcorn machine. Yeah. I like that. The cacophony.